We will talk of pricing today. We had done initial part of it. So in initial part, we have talked about something about price, which is very much essential for us to understand before selecting or putting a price to a product or a brand. We have talked about that, what should be kept in mind. We have talked about that, how the scenario is changing today. And what do we mean by changing scenario is that today we have access to best of best locations, best of best brands, and we can also know the prices of the product across the boards also. So that is something that you have to keep it in mind. You also have to keep it in mind the other things like name the price and have it met. So you keep the price of it, and then the marketer is maybe will be able to provide you with that price, right? So we have also talked about the free software movement. So in this era, you have to work out. We have also talked about message marketing, the message pricing. We have also talked about perceived pricing, which is that 9-9 thing. What does the 9-9 has a value in it? So why do we keep the pricing of a product in 9-9, 1-9-9, 2-9-9 or 3-9-9? So that is also we have talked about. So with all that in our kitty, let us transgress the discussion ahead. And today we will very quickly talk of these 6 steps which are considered while selecting the price of a product. Those who are in BBA would have essentially done it, and those who are not, I think it will not be a very, very difficult thing for you to understand also, right? So let us start this process. As you can see, first we talk of pricing objective, but then we go to demand, we go to estimation of cost, and then we go to competition analysis, and then pricing method, and then we select the final price. So this is something which is carried out. Now, just to make a sense of all these 6 steps, let us talk of one by one. So first we start with selecting the price objective. Now, pricing is also done with an objective in mind. So there is this marketing objective that you are trying to achieve, and all the 4 P's of marketing, what if it is product, what if it is price, what if it is place or promotion, they are all, you know, helping to achieve that overall marketing objective only. And to achieve that objective, you can also keep objective to pricing also, right? Now, it might sound peculiar and Tom, Dick and Harry to you that how does objective in pricing can play a role? It actually has a larger role to play. Now, look at these 4 contexts in which we can think that what can be the potential, you know, objective which I am trying to achieve by keeping a price in such a way that the objective is actually achieved. For example, some companies might be considering the survival as their objective. So, the competition has become intense. The competition is also getting quality products to the consumers, and the consumers is actually going to the competition. So your only objective is to just to get and maintain your position in the market. So you are just talking of survival. You are not talking of bullying onto the market. So in that case, you will keep the price in such a way so that it is not much different from your competition. You are only trying to recover the costs which you are incurring while producing this product. You are not thinking of much of the profits, because there are times when you just try to pass that time. So 2008, when you know the whole the world was down in terms of monetary things, you were just trying to pass this time. And when you were trying to pass this time, people were not able to, and people were not willing to shell the money out of their pockets. You were just only thinking of covering your cost, not thinking majorly about anything. So if that is your objective, then you have to keep accordingly, if you have to set your prices accordingly. For example, you can try to maximize your current profits. Current profits maximization means what? That you will keep as much price as possible. You will try to achieve the premium over and above the cost that you are actually incurring in the production of that product. If that is your objective, then obviously you will keep a lot of difference between the cost that you incurred in production of this product to the price that you are actually keeping for it. You can also think of maximizing the market share. Maximizing market share would mean what? It would mean to penetrate into the market. And market penetration is such a wonderful strategy in the sense that you will find so many manufacturers and marketers and business houses, they are only concerned about this thing, and later on the things would follow. Lot of people argue, because since the Jio thing has happened, lot of people are actually talking of so many strategies that Jio would have potentially accepted. But many people, they say that they are actually trying to create and cover up a larger share in the market. And how can they achieve it? They can achieve it by keeping the price minimum. And when they are trying to keep the prices minimum, the people would come to you and people would try to experience your product. And hence, what if you are bearing losses, but at least you are getting penetrated into the market. and more people are using you, and then later on you can actually play with the price again and you can then escalate it. But then if you're thinking of getting a larger market share, then penetration is your objective, then the prices are going to be less in a country like ours, because we are a very price sensitive country. Maybe there are some countries where the prices should not be kept less, even if you want to penetrate, because these can be the people who feel like that the price is less, then the product is also not good. So we might talk of some of those countries.
Developed countries,
and to be very specific, Luxembourg is one country. Right? In Luxembourg, if you would say, I have kept a slide for that country also in this discussion only, wherein if you are in Luxembourg and if you are selling cheap products, I mean, they would not buy it. They would say, no, it is not a good product. Because if you would look at the, per capita income of Luxembourg, it is too much considering the other nations, and people have a lot of money at their disposal. And hence, they would like to get the better things in place. And that is why you should not better be keeping a low price if you want to penetrate well into the market, and the market as good as Luxembourg. You can also have an objective which is market skimming. What is skimming? Skimming kya hota hai? So you are actually telling what this objective is about. So you are right when you say that the skimming means keeping the price high. But skimming, if you would read the Latin meaning of it, you will realize that skimming means upar ka jo main cheez hai na wo utar lena, jaise doodh mein malai aati hai na, usko skim kar lena upar se. So which means there is money lying in the market, so you just take that money out. Right? And how do you do that? You do that by keeping the prices too high. So this actually is exercised by the people who launch the products which are new. So Sony has been exercising this strategy. Sony has been doing that. They have been keeping the prices of their new products very high. And down the line, when the time passes, they will get the prices low. And they have done the skimming by then. So which means the money... In any market, there is some money which will be going into experimentation. There are people who are early adopters. They would always be keeping this money in their belly. And it is about this money. And if you can skim this money out of the market, you are actually exercising market skimming. So this can also be your objective. So when this is your objective, keep the prices high. So these are your different objectives. Now this is about Sony HDTV. If you would look at HDTV when they first launched it in 1990, they have kept 43 grand. Dollars as the price of their HDTV, so which was subsequently lessened down to 1200 today, or in 2007, not today, still the 10 years has gone since that time also. So this is a typical example of market skimming. Not only this product, if you would look at the other products of Sony, you would realize that they have been doing this in stages, right? The second step in pricing is to determine the demand. Demand is a very important element to understand while trying to fix price of any product. And why it is an important product is because it actually shares a very, very important relationship with price. You would have done it in managerial economics. There is something which is called as price demand curve, right? So when you are increasing the price, the demand also changes. And there is inverse relationship between these two, right? So you have to understand this demand also. So demand is understood by looking at the price sensitivity of the market. So price sensitivity would means that when you are increasing the price, how much the demand is being affected. So if by increasing a smaller price, the demand, larger demand is getting affected, then it means the market is price sensitive. And if by increasing the price, the market is not getting affected to the larger extent, then you would say that the market is not that price sensitive. So we are a very price sensitive country, right? So keeping our thing in mind, we have to play very, very sharp when it comes on to escalating the prices. And not only escalating the prices, but also when you're trying to get down the prices also. Because it is always easier for you as a marketer to climb down the prices, but again, if you want to get it back, it is very difficult to achieve that. The market might not accept it, right? So this is how we look at the determining demand. Now, this is what we were talking about. This is something which is called as inelastic demand and elastic demand. In the second thing, you can see that it is something which is highly, kind of elastic market. So it is a price sensitive market. So just increasing the price would actually decrease the demand to a greater extent, right? So this is how the price elasticity comes into picture. Now this is what I was actually talking about the Luxembourg. If you would look at the minimum wages that you get in Luxembourg, in one of the countries in Europe, you will find out that it is larger than so many other countries. It is 1923 per month. You multiply it by whatever the euro. It is 2 days back. It was around 79.18. So you can multiply it with that and you get a number. So this is the kind of wages. And if you would read about the demographics and the market scenario of the Luxembourg and the purchasing power of the people, you would realize that the people would like to spend lavishly because they have larger money to spend with them, right? So this is how we look at all those things. Now, then in third thing, after understanding the demand, you talk of estimating the costs also. And this is a very wonderful diagram which is symbolically telling you the importance of the relationship which the price and demand shares with each other. You would see to it there is red slot into this strip and which is cost part. And there is a yellow strip to it which is profit part. So cost plus profit becomes the price floor. And this is something that you would like to keep the minimum price. You would not like to get below this because then you would actually be getting into maybe losses. The projected revenues would not be achieved by your company. And then there is a top ceiling to it, which is also called as price ceiling. Now that should not, overpower the demand of the product into the market. So which means there is a point beyond which increasing the price after this point would devastatively affect the demand of the product in the market, and you need to understand that point. And that point can be understood by the perspective of the price ceiling. You should never try to escalate the prices beyond that point, because then it will actually impact. See, it is all about the overall revenue that you are getting. It might be that you will increase the price, you are getting profit per unit more, but cumulatively you are selling less in numbers, and hence the overall figure is going to be less. If you would look at the two propositions, proposition number one, wherein you are getting larger profit per unit, but you are selling less in number. Proposition number two, you are getting lesser profit per unit, but your numbers are larger. Which one is better for a businessman? Obviously, it is second one, because then his product is being spread to a larger market. More number of people are using it. So the cumulative profit and revenues are going to be the same in both the propositions. So the second proposition is a better proposition. So you better be very sensitive to that ceiling of the price beyond which the demand is being impacted heavily. And you just better keep that as to be your price ceiling. Don't try to escalate the price beyond that point. You keep it low. And in fact, you have to do this maths. And this maths is about that minimum profit if you want to achieve, you do that. But increase the volume of your, units that are selling into the market. Now that would always be a better proposition rather than to that proposition wherein your profit is too high but you're selling less in number, right? At least in consumer goods. So this is very much important to understand. Now the costs can be estimated. You all know very basic principle, fixed cost, when you add variable cost into it, you get total cost. And the whole idea behind the pricing is to cover this cost after considering the profits. So the profits are added into this cost and then you keep the price of it, and that becomes your price floor. And beyond that, you whatever premium you want to charge, that depends upon what type of brand you are, what type of image that you actually enjoy and exercise in the market. This is another important thing to understand. If you would go back to your learnings from managerial economics, you would have perhaps come across short run average cost. Now that is your SRAC. So short run average cost would mean that for a shorter duration, there is a relationship which the quantity which is being produced by you and the cost that you are incurring in production of it actually shares with each other. So if you would look at this curve, you would realize that there is a point at which it becomes minimum, right? So that is the optimal production that you should actually do. Below this point also, you are actually getting more cost per unit, and beyond this point also you are getting more cost per unit. So for you, it would be optimal to produce at this point, which is say 1,000 units per day. There is also something which is called as long run average cost, whatever you may call it. Now this is actually about considering the market, considering the labor, considering the overall cost. What would be the optimal number of production by which you can actually achieve the minimum cost per unit? If you can compare these two, you would realize something which is very important to understand. When you are only doing a short run thing, you are getting 100 as your minimum or optimal size of production. But if you would look at in long range, you will find that it is around 4,000 units which you should purchase every day. And if you would not purchase, produce every day. And if you would produce 4,000 every day, then the unit cost of each unit is going to be minimum, right? And then you actually would go after this thing, which means you should better be expanding your facility. You should better be expanding your market. And that actually gives you a very, very important lesson. And I'm taking it back from the point when we were understanding that it is better to spread into the market by keeping the margin low rather than keeping the margin high and getting concentrated only to a point of the market. And this is something which actually goes around it. So if you are selling more volumes, then eventually the cost per unit also gets lower. And that is what this curve is telling you. I think we have done it, activity-based costing, how to arrive at the cost. I do not know whether you can recall it or not, but to give you a very quick snapshot of it, activity-based costing is a principle which says that to arrive at the cost of any activity that you do, or any job that you do, or any product that you produce, what you have to do, you have to identify the activities which you are doing while producing this product. So in able to produce this podium, you can actually note down 25 activities which potentially you say would have been carried out before finally this podium was being built. So number one could be cutting a log of wood. Number two could be transporting it to the factory. Number three could be then further furnishing up. So this could be 25 things. For every activity you can have a cost. And when you will add up this cost, you will get the total cost of it. So this is activity based costing. If you want to actually reach to a better understanding of the cost of any production, then activity-based costing can be a better method to do that. Now, this is the principle that we talk of. Very much important, if you today start producing chips, you would never be able to scale it down to the point where maybe the Frito-Lay division of Pepsi is able to scale it for their Lay's chips, which means for every 20 grams of chips which the Lay's is producing, the kind of cost that they are incurring into it, that cost you can never achieve. You will always be able to produce at a level which is quite high. Just to put the things in perspective, only this weekend, one of your seniors, I do not know whether you know him or not, super seniors, not your seniors, but super seniors who are passed out, he's from Ghaziabad and he called me. He said that, sir, I have started a work of my own and he's, producing the biscuits, the protein biscuits, and he has invested 22 to 25 lakh rupees on it. And he's saying, sir, my quality is very good and I bet that the protein biscuits which are there in market, which are selling in say 150 bucks or say 200 bucks, my costing would be quite less. But then the point is, I'll be able to sell it in a very less price. But then the point is, for such a biscuit, my packaging cost is 12 rupees per package. I mean, that is too much. 12 rupees per package. I mean, what will you get? When will you talk of margin then? He says, if I am to talk of the packaging, which is parallel to the packaging of the established brand, it would cost me 12 rupees. Wherein the people like established players would actually be getting it in very, very low cost. And that is where the experience curve actually comes into place. It is not only volume, but it is also the learning that you do along with time. Just to give a very typical example of it, that Texas Instruments is a company which produces calculators, right? The small calculators they produce. They also produce big calculators. They say that I challenge if someone can produce the calculators at a lower cost than I do. So, and this is what they do, right? So they say that I'm able to produce a calculator as low as say $8. I mean, it can be a big calculator, whatever. So no one can achieve that economy of scale. So that is their experience curve that we're talking about, right? So with time, you become more efficient. That is what it tells you, right? Then the next step is to analyze the competition. Many a times you will see that the competition in fact becomes the base of your price. At what price your competition is selling in the market? You have to look at it. And because when we were doing the pricing, and when we were discussing that the consumer today has become conscious of the price that he is paying for, it is not blindly paying you, he is actually evaluating the value proposition that you are offering him. And we were also talking about a frame of reference that he always referred to when he is saying that how costly or what would be the price of this. if I give you anything and if I ask you that what would be the price of it, then you would say there is it would be of this much. So when you say it would be of this much, there is a frame of reference in your mind against which you are actually evaluating it, and then you are saying it should be of this much. So that frame of reference, it is said and it has been proved by multiple researches, actually the competition price actually plays a larger than life role in framing your that reference. So you say that this laptop is being sold by Sony, another company who is manufacturing the laptops, you would say it is expensive or it is less expensive, you will only be able to tell it while you compare it with the competition. You say that they are selling in that much, so you are selling in that much, so that frame of reference is this. And that frame of reference is coming from your competition. So that is why competition is actually very, very important, because evaluating, when consumer would say, is it worth to give this much of money for this product, he will actually be keeping in mind what price the competition is selling for in this market. So this is something which is again important to understand. Then the last leg of it, because thereafter it is very, very small things. Having known all those things, you can then actually talk of the pricing methods. And the pricing methods could be this much. You can talk of the 6 pricing methods. You can talk of markup pricing. You can talk of target return. You can talk of perceived value. You can talk of value pricing. You can talk of going rate and auction type. This could be the various methods which your text talks about while you are talking of pricing strategy. So let us talk about them one by one. It's simple, super simple maths, no rocket science in it, and I think we should be able to get it in first go. Let us talk of markup pricing. Markup pricing is the simplest methods of fixing the price. So what do? You just calculate your cost and you add a markup to it. So markup means profit. So you just simply identify what is your variable cost. So considering the above figures in mind, if your variable cost per toaster, which is the product, is say $10, and if your fixed cost is $300,000, then your expected sales is say 50,000 units, then you can always calculate the unit cost, right? And now markup is simply that how much you want to charge over and above it. So you say, I want to earn 20% at every unit. So you just make what is the 20% of 16. So that would be how much? What would be the 20% of 3.2 or 3.5 or whatever. So if you can kind of round it off, you say that I will keep it as 20 rupees as this price. So this is a simple math that you can do. Simple. Calculate the unit price of it, and then you keep a markup onto it, and then add it into it, and then you say that this is my pricing. Okay. Then target return pricing. You say that what is my ROI, return on investment. How much return do you want on your investment? So you say 20% return I would like to have. So for that also, you just keep the units and the numbers into this formula. And then you calculate it that it should be around 20, keeping the figures in mind. So you just have to delete this thing, X thing. X is mistakenly finding its place. So today when I was typing it out, it mistakenly got into place. 2 times the equation got inserted. So the equation that you have to look at it is this thing. Unit cost plus desired return multiplied by invested capital divided by unit sales. And you add it into unit cost. So if you are thinking that you will be able to sell 50,000 units and your desired return is 20% and your invested capital is say $10,000 and your unit price is 16, then you should keep the price at $20 for unit, so to achieve a return on investment of 20%. So this is the formula that you do, and it is easy to understand also. What is this thing, desired return multiplied by invested capital? So if you have invested 10,000, then this is your capital that you're investing and you are expecting a return of 20% on it. So multiplying invested capital by desired return would actually be able to tell you, is in very simple mathematical terms, that this much you want to get back. And how you have to get back? You have to get back by selling these units. And this is why you add it into the unit cost by dividing it with the total sales that you are expecting to happen. So that would give you the price of it. That is ROI method. You can also calculate the break-even volume. Break-even volume is the quantity at which you will be achieving the no profit, no loss situation. Right? So you just put the values in this formula. and you will get a volume that if you are able to sell this much of units, you will be at the stage of no profit and no loss. And beyond this point, you will start making profits, not losses. After that, you will start making profits. Then is perceived value pricing. Perceived value pricing is what? What is consumer perceiving? And this perceived value pricing is something which is making a lot of rounds today. In the sense, if you are a new man in the market, you might need markup, you might need ROI. But if you are established player, if you are a brand, you talk of this thing. Because consumer perception has already been generated about you because you are a brand. And when we're talking about brand, we're talking of and the undifferentiated perception that has been created in the mind of the people about your brand. So this undifferentiated perception is something which is differentiating this brand from the competition. And when it is differentiating this brand from the competition, you are saying, I am different. And for this difference, you can charge an extra price. And that is something you call as premium. So that premium, actually something you add on to your simple mathematical calculations that you have done in the previous two methods. And that's something you can term it as consumer perceived price and consumer perceived value. So you can look at any of the brands and you will be talking of consumer perceived price only. You are not talking of simple mathematical price and profit price. I hope you can recall when I was sharing with you that the VNCC, when they are selling their facial kits, are able to generate it per unit in under 100 rupees, and then they are selling into the market at 800 rupees. And people are very happy to pay for it because they feel it is so close to their hearts. And when it comes on to looks, the people are extra conscious and they are willing to spend extra money on it also. Right? So this is perceived value pricing only. The way you perceive, the way you pay. Yes.
Naturally, they sell prices increase, double kar diye. Usme sir, jo strength pe bhi effect pada tha, jo daily passenger pe, unka overall profit bada tha, to isi mein aayega perceived.
Nahi. Dekhiye, you have to look at so many other things also. So you cannot put the increase prices of metro into this. One thing is that you are maybe as metro thinking of the profits and the cost that you are incurring. Maybe who knows that the metro has started incurring more cost because of say the higher electricity charges, because of the higher maintenance charges, because they are expanding. So all that actually is asking them to increase the price if they want to sustain for long. Now second thing is there are some categories in which the products can be classified. Number one is there is something which is called as the essential products. Metro in Delhi is life. Suburban railways in Mumbai are life. People, you take your car out in Delhi and you travel the distance of 5 kilometers for your office and you would like, no, metro is far better. Right? So it has become an essential service. So people will object to it for some time, but then there is something which is called as the overall life of the product and overall cost that you are paying for it. Still by increasing that price, you are actually saving the money in comparison to the other methods of traveling. Right? So if you travel by bus, it is not a good way of traveling. You don't feel comfortable. It is a better method, and if they are charging high, you will pay for it. Right? So essential commodity is something else. Then the example that I gave of VLCC, that is not an essential commodity. That is a luxurious goods. So you will not die because of that. You have to go office daily. And that is why you have to commute. And when you have to commute, you will look after the options. And when you are looking after the options, metro is still better. Right? So that is how you look at it. Okay. Then you talk of value pricing. This is a new concept which has come up. Value pricing is about offering the product at the minimum possible price to the consumer. How you will do it, there can be n number of ways it can be done. Many people are doing it. Now, for example, Southwest Airlines, Indigo Airlines, Go Airways, they are trying to offer the air travel at the minimum possible cost. So that is why they call themselves as to be low-cost carriers, right? Vishal Abhinamart says, I am the cheapest. Walmart says, I am the cheapest. And if you would go to the retail outlets, a new term has emerged, which is EDLP, every day low pricing. You have also specific stores for it. So 99 store. So 99 store is, you will find everything under 99 only. So this is a new thing which has actually come up into the market. and it is about providing the things to the consumer at a lower rate, and the consumer is also happy and the retailer is also very happy. So when Big Bazaar is able to sell you maybe at a lower price, it is not that he's doing a charity. It is that he's actually earning a lot on it. So he would be ordering, say, 10,000 units of Pepsodent at one go. So 10,000 units of Pepsodent, he's able to kind of command some type of margin onto it. And then he's selling it at a lower rate. And you say that, oh, I'm a good man and Big Bazaar are good people. But end of the day, they are actually making a lot on it. So this is the concept of EDLP. This is the concept of value pricing. Then is going rate pricing. Follow the Jones notion. It's a popular term in marketing. Follow the Jones notion. So Jones is anyone out there in the competition. Whatever the competition is keeping you, just keep that. So don't look after markup, don't look after the cost, don't look after this and that, because the point is that you will not be able to sell if you differentiate too much in terms of pricing by keeping this difference on the higher side. People will not buy you, right? So this is follow the Jones notion. People say that it is a better strategy when you talk of commodities, but not onto the specific products. Commodities are what? Commodities are those products which are very difficult to differentiate from the competition. Now, for example, Tata is selling steel. So there would be some other people also who would be into the steel business, say Jindal Steel. So the type of technology that these both are using is actually kind of same. So the type of product that you will be getting would also be type of a same. So there is no much differentiation possible in these products. For those, whatever is the trend, whatever is the price into the market, you just go with that price, and that is something which is called as going rate pricing. People say that it should be avoided, that if you go with going rate pricing for the consumer products, those products who do not potentially fall into the category of commodities, right? That is how you talk about it. And then is auction pricing. You all understand what is auction, right? So auction, you do not fix the price. The price is fixed by a process, right? And what is that process? You talk of three type of auctions: English auction, Dutch auction, and sealed bid auction. English auction is something that you start from a lower point, and then the people would bid for a higher amount, and whosoever who bid the highest, you keep a lower value to it, obviously, right? So you as a bidder would say that the bid is starting from, say, 20 rupees, and then someone would say 30, 35, 40, 45, you will keep a low value to it, right? So that is your English auction. Smaller price, escalate it. Whosoever bid for the maximum, that is the price of it, right? Dutch auction is just opposite to that. I say that I will sell this laptop in 5 lakh rupees. Doesn't make sense. No one will purchase it. Then someone would say 50,000, directly from 5 lakh to 50,000. I say it is okay. 50,000 is still okay. And then people will play around it. Someone will increase it, someone will decrease it, someone will do that, someone, and whatever, you know, the maximum that you can get, you just fix it, that this is going to be the price of it. Not many people would do that, but it is recommended when you actually are trying to sell a product which is not a regular product. Now, for example, what do I mean by that? Tender is a different. Oh, that is a sealed bit. See, this Dutch auction, many people do for, you know, what type of product do you call as? Antique pieces. Antique is the word. Antique, the you know, the kind of products which has some artistic value into it. So people would say, I will not sell it, say, less than 50,000 rupees. You don't feel that it is worth that. Then someone would say 40,000 I am able to get. Then you say, I will make it 42. Right? So something happened. Whatever maximum you can get, you seal it up. So that is your Dutch auction. Sealed bid is the tender system that we talk of. Government agencies goes for sealed bid auction. So sealed bid auction is wherein no one knows what are the prices which are quoted. And if you would go to tenders, you will find that there are two steps into it. First step is to prove your eligibility, and second step is to offer the least price of it. So that is your sealed bid auction price. Mainly the government agencies goes after it. Then the last point, keeping all that in mind, you select the final price. Now, whatever is suggested by all those earlier methods, what if it is markup, what if it is value pricing, what if it is some other methods, what if it is ROI method. Now, over and above, you can also take some decisions. Maybe that the markup would say that it should be this much, and then you would look at the other things also. What is the brand quality? What is impact on others? What are pricing policies? What are the gain and risk sharing? Keeping all that in mind, you can also escalate or de-escalate the price. So ultimate, it is going to be you who will then be something adding into it or something getting out of it. So this is how you fix it up, and this is how the traditional method of fixing the price for a product was actually being taken care of. Needless to say, I will again emphasize that we had in our earlier talk on pricing, were talking about some very, very important contexts which would therefore affect the way you will price your product. You go with markup, you go with ROI, you go with value, you go with perceived value pricing, you go whatever method you want to go with, but then you, after getting the result out of it, you brainstorm this step, the last step, selecting the final price by keeping all the previous things in mind, right? So you cannot ask unreasonable premiums because you feel like the people don't know what the competition is offering. You will have to know this, right? So keeping all that, keeping these methods in mind, you fix a final price to it, and this is how people try to do it. This is how the prices are set. Okay, so this is the discussion on pricing. If any questions on this, please let me know.